I'm in the KLM hangar here. This is a Dreamliner. Thanks for having me on the Dreamliner cockpit here.
This is very much a realistic idea for a new passenger aircraft.
So right now we're standing in the mock-up section of the Flying V.
When do you expect to see the Flying V, this model, and the reality one takes off?
Welcome on board. My next stop is Amsterdam.
So I just arrived in Amsterdam here at the KLM Engineering Service to learn about what KLM is doing to sustain the future aviation. So Ramona, what are we going to see today?
Yeah.
What you guys have done so far?
Yeah, so today I'm going to explain you a bit more about what our sustainability approach is in general. Then we will show you 3D printing initiative with recycled materials. You will talk with our fuel director on sustainable aviation fuel. Then you will see one of our purses talking about our closed loop initiative. And you will see a pilot talking about efficiency. And I think tomorrow you also go to Technical University in Delft.
Right.
About our Flying V project.
Hi there.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Marlette van der Veer.
Very tall.
It's true. Welcome to the Engine Services Makerspace, where this is one out of 8 innovation hubs where we do 3D printing in engineering and maintenance.
I have no understanding what's 3D printing, so show me what you guys doing.
So what we're printing here are aircraft tools that are tools that support the maintenance process of our aircraft. This is a fan blade cover, and if you are standing in front of an engine, you'll see a lot of these blades. And during the maintenance process, we need to shot pin them. So we started thinking, how can we use 3D printing as a method to create tools that make the maintenance process faster, safer, or more durable. At this moment, we did a pilot of 1 week where we used all the PET plastic waste of 1 week of our operation to create 150 kilos of filament. So 1 week gives you 150 rolls of these.
So Sam, here's a table we made for the new KLM headquarters. It's made out of recycled plastic and it's made by topology optimization. You can see it with a special type of support down here. It's calculated to reduce waste material, and it is supposed to be able to support about 150 kilograms.
Right, so it's made from plastic bottles to make a furniture, a table for the KLM headquarters.
Definitely, yeah.
150 kilo, I'm about that. Let me do a stress test on your product. Yeah, very stable. I sit on a crack. Yes, how many hours it took you to develop this?
To print it, it took about 240 hours, I think. So,
240 hours,
yeah,
but this is
it.
All unmanned. The machine is doing by itself.
Yeah, the machine, you program it in, and then it prints it out for you.
So what I actually made here was the KLM 100 year house, and I made it especially for you with
wow.
Material from the recycling plant.
My God. What is really cool, I'm absolutely stunned, because 3D painting can make just like the original, look at the Delft blue house, this is almost the same shape, but this is created by recycled products.
Indeed.
You know? Wow.
So that could be your PET bottle that you used one time in a KLM flight.
That's really cool. Thank you so much. This is a great idea. Brilliant.
I'm in the KLM hangar here. This is a Dreamliner. I'm going to go inside a 787 Dreamliner to discover and learn a bit more about sustainability inside this Dreamliner. So I got on board the Dreamliner, and in the galley here, Purser Mayo and two ladies here is gonna explain to me, they're showing me their latest KLM recyclable products will be used on board.
So Maya, can you explain a bit more about what's behind this, how you came up with this idea?
Normally, these items are thrown away after the flight.
Yeah.
And now we collected all items from four flights from Vancouver to Amsterdam, cleaned it, recycled it, and used it again on a flight from Amsterdam to Vancouver. So we didn't throw it away, we used the materials again.
You recycle all the stuff from a flight from Vancouver and then use them again after recycling. These are the new products and on the flight back to Vancouver.
Yes.
This is what you have done, yeah?
Yes. With the main meal dish, the salad bowl, the glass, and the cutlery.
I want to check your cutlery, because your cutlery is metal, because you can wash them,
and
or this is
plastic. Plastic, yes.
Yeah. So why you use plastic? Because I thought plastic is harmful to the environment.
Well, if you throw it away in nature, it's harmful.
Okay.
But we use it again. We wash it and clean it.
You wash the plastic and reuse them?
Yes, for this test flight to Vancouver. It is a really good quality, so we can wash it and use it again.
What's the feedback so far? Did the passenger notice the difference? Or?
Yes, we made an announcement in which we explained what we were doing, and they reacted very enthusiastic.
Passengers help us with separating the plastic. When we, on a European flight for example, come by to collect all the plastic waste, we separate the bottles and the cans from the meal boxes, and they actually help us, so it becomes easier for us to do it.
That's great to hear. Wish more airlines doing the same thing.
Look at the carpet.
Yeah?
If you look at the carpet, you look at the blue, and the blue in my uniform.
Mm.
Do you have an idea?
No idea, but I just see dots, but
well,
I don't know.
The blue that you see in the carpet, the same blue as my uniform, is actually made from the uniforms, our old uniforms. So KLM recycled it, yes, and they made carpet from it.
I'm also going to try out your new seats here on the 787.
Yeah, this is the new layout.
The KLM Dreamliner. Yeah, good seats, huh?
It's like a small house.
Oh, hi. We can see yourself here. It's nice, very nice, like a blue house, open and closed like that.
And
look
you
at
see
this.
How handsome you are after a 24-hour flight, eh?
Oh yes, yeah. After a long flight I became handsome. So Captain Amerville, thanks for having me on the Dreamliner cockpit here. So I want to know from a captain perspective, from a pilot perspective, what are you guys doing to be more sustainable in aviation?
Very good question. We can do a lot. As our pilots, because we are handling the thrust levers. We are dealing with the amount of fuel. And so we can do a lot of things. And we say to our pilots, if you can earn only 50 kilos each flight, that's nothing compares how much fuel is in the tanks. But you add it up each flight, each day, and in the end of the year, you have a lot of amount of fuel earned, and therefore also CO2. And you can do, you can postpone the moment of starting your engines. You can, when you taxi in, you can shut on one engine. So you taxi only on one engine to the gate. But it's completely safe and it's completely okay, but you save a lot of money. You can postpone your moment of starting descent. You can postpone your moment setting flaps to have less drag, so to earn some fuel.
You need to coordinate with ATC. You can't just make a decision on your own to when to start the descent or, you know, to line up the runway and...
Yes, of course, and it's depending on the airport you're flying to, because John F. Kennedy, New York is quite busy, so you're not entitled to have a lot of room for your decisions. But when you fly, let's say, within Europe, like Göteborg or another, it's not that busy, so you have more space. But of course, even at Schiphol, you can postpone if you always looking for the small things to gain. In the end, you end up with a lot of earning on fuel.
Then thank you very much for sharing all the insight with me today.
Yeah,
thank you.
You're welcome. Very good. Thank you.
But what exactly is sustainable aviation fuel? Can you explain a bit more to me?
Yeah, so sustainable aviation fuel for us is fuel that is made from a waste product and converted into a fuel which is comparable to the normal fuel.
Because I heard lots of people mentioning biofuel, and also people talk about synthetic fuel.
Yeah.
So is this all sustainable aviation fuel you're trying to take?
Not really. The biofuel is we see as first generation fuel, which is created from either palm oil or soya oil. And there we see a sustainability challenge because the farmers there are cutting down forests to create the palm plantations, and that's something we do not like. So we really want to focus on waste streams, so waste cooking oil. And then you have the synthetic fuel, which is something where you take CO2 out of the air and convert that into a sustainable aviation fuel. Challenges there is the energy that is required and also the price. So the price is 2 to 2.5 times as expensive as normal fuel. It's also 10 years away because it's a big challenge to get the price down and to have enough factories in the world because there are not enough now. And they're also at a study phase. So there's still a lot of challenges to be met.
Look at this, a very unconventional, futuristic design of the airplane. A V-shaped fuselage, engine mounted at the back, not those round fuselage conventional design. I'm at the TU Delft, Delft University of Technology here in Holland. Malcolm, thank you very much for inviting me here.
Thank you.
Tell me more about this flying V. Is this really a realistic idea, or this is just someone sci-fi idea on the drawing board?
This is very much a realistic idea for a new passenger aircraft. So with this concept, it's based on the A350 design. So it also carries 315 passengers and flies 5,000 nautical miles. And with the design of the aircraft, so purely from this V shape and being a flying wing, from all of those benefits, we're able to save 20% fuel in respect to the A350.
So Malcolm, looking at this electric fan engine, it can power the model, right? But what about the real one-to-one scale powering?
Currently for the design, we're using the engine from the A350, so that's a big turbofan engine that runs on kerosene. That 20% reduction comes purely from the aerodynamics and not from an improved engine technology. So the unconventional V design. And in future, we are also looking at other engine options such as synthetic fuel, hydrogen, or maybe hybrid electric aircraft. But once the technology improves and it becomes ready for that kind of integration, we can also integrate that into the.
So Malcolm, I guess the big question is, when do you expect to see the Flying V, this model, and the reality one takes off?
This model, once we are finished building it, will fly later this year. So then we're going to take the test flying and check that all the aerodynamics of this model. But then the results of that will be used to carry on the design, which will still take quite a long time because there's a long design road ahead. So we hope that in between 2035 to 2040 that the full scale design will be finished, where the passengers can then go and enjoy the Flying V. But for the moment, I invite you to go and check out the, we have a mock-up of the full-scale cabin, so then you can also see where the what's the passenger experience in that new cabin and the oval section, because there's also different seating options and different comfort ideas for the passenger of also how to improve the passenger experience in the flight.
So right now we're standing in the mock-up section of the Flying V. This is the same width as an A350 Airbus. And what you have to imagine right now is we have economy class.
Yep.
And we have different solutions for more comfort in economy class in the Flying V. Now the one thing you're not seeing, which is our centerpiece, are the staggered seats, which make sure that you sit in the direction of which you fly, which is nice. But we have some other very cool concepts that we'd like you to see.
Hey, but I'm seeing there are people here trying out, right? They're designing the cabin.
We have some students here, some design students, and they can tell you a little bit more about each individual concept for economy.
Oh yeah, it really fits 4 people here, right? This is like the good old days with aviation when they fly the planes all along. Those planes used to fly very slow and then they need time to do like this family time together.
Yeah, with this you can allow people to sit more closely to each other, and it's actually taking the same space as 2 rows of seats.
Right, it's just 2 rows, 1 row there and 1 row, but we're just facing each other, that's all it is. Just reverse the seat and you create a good family area or a social area, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Pretty cool. So I don't quite get it. This is like one is higher, and then there look like a swing here, the design, and one is lower. So is that going to be staggered, like high, low, like this?
Yes, exactly like that. It will be staggered. The idea is we stagger it high, low, because this way the seat itself can change into about three positions. You can slide under and be very comfortable laying
like this
laying,
guy.
Like that guy. You could sit up normally, mm-hmm. or you could even stand and lean for a bit.
Ah, okay, you can stand and lean.
Because the number one priority is change your position. Yeah. Every hour, change your position a bit. That way you don't get those tired legs.
Yeah, and then because you see like it's you have a lot of headroom to utilize.
You have headroom to utilize and you have room underneath in this position.
And this is actually free beds. And it appeared in research that 60% wants to sleep on a long haul flight. So we were thinking, how can we enable that? So with these three beds, we can allow three persons to sleep. And during takeoff and landing, of course, people have to be able to sit in the seat belts. So therefore, the lowest bed can be folded, and then three persons can sit next to each other in the seat belt.
We're listening to her idea, but we're also proving this idea. So this worked, hey?
Yeah,
so during takeoff and landing, we'll sit here. And after takeoff, and we go into our bed. Yeah. That's pretty cool. Is this actually economy class? This is like, or you don't have economy class, this is all
so
one?
Yeah, so this is really, to enable economy class to be able to sleep as well. With the same price as it is.
Wicked idea. This will be a winner, really. Like, after takeoff, go straight to your... Oh, there's a person here. Shucks. I was thinking I was touching someone's feet there. Much, Captain, and everyone showing me the environment initiative KLM is taking. I know this is KLM 100th birthday this year, and I wish KLM many, many more 100th birthday to come.
Hoorah!